The Easy Step-by-Step Guide to Recruiting the Right Staff by Chris Dukes. Introduction. In these times of restructuring and downsizing, everyone is expected to do not just his or her own job, but take on additional roles, some of which are new territory. Whether recruitment is one of your many functions, a sporadic one, or simply new to you, there are two core concepts you need to take on board. Employing the right people is critical to the success of any business, and the total staff base is probably your company's most expensive asset. Recruitment is purchasing an asset for your company. Appointing the wrong person can be expensive, not only in monetary terms, but also in terms of wasted time and energy. It can also lead to internal conflict, higher absenteeism, and lost production time. Recruitment, therefore, isn't simply about discovering ways to get hold of someone quickly to fill a gap. That would be a dangerously naive thought process from someone in a position of responsibility. Recruitment is about an analysis of your company's needs and, most important, educating yourself to be able to fill that need to the most satisfactory conclusion for both company and prospective employee. So what is there to know about recruitment? It can't be difficult. After all, there are experts around to do that job for you. You can just pick up the telephone, call the nearest recruitment agency, and believe me, they'd be so pleased to hear from you. And then you just sit back and let them do their job. Think again. Even if the logical end process is that you do pick up the telephone and ask the recruitment agency to act on your behalf, they're working for you. So if you don't know your exact requirements, how can you expect the agency to fulfill them satisfactorily? It's easy to recruit. It's not so easy to get it right. How to use this guide? The guide is designed to be a reference tool to help perform the recruitment function, and therefore to be an aid memoir. Listen to it to hone your awareness of what recruitment really means. Listen to it to improve your knowledge of the processes involved. Get those who work with you and those for whom you are recruiting to listen to the guide to promote a unified approach to each recruitment project. Use the guide to help you evaluate each vacancy on its own merits and recruit the best possible person to fulfill those requirements. Listen to the guide more than once to help you remember the most important points. What you will learn from this guide. This guide can't assess your particular recruitment needs for this vacancy at this time. Only you can do that. But what it will provide: a framework to constructive thought, a template for subsequent action. It will assist you to think logically about your requirements, formulate a plan of action, proceed with your recruitment drive in the knowledge that you have a coherent end game. In short, it'll put your recruitment cogs into gear. And note, to avoid confusion and the cumbersome usage of he or she throughout the guide, the applicant or candidate will be referred to in the male gender. This should in no way prejudice your recruitment concepts. Chapter 1. Panic Stations. You're losing a valuable employee, you have a new project to cover, or your workload has increased and you simply need to recruit someone to shoulder some of the burden. Whatever the reason, you need to get someone in quickly. You haven't got time to mess around. After all, you're a very busy person and time is money. If this is your initial reaction, you're panicking. A panicking person doesn't make rational decisions. Stop and think. Getting it wrong is potentially far more costly in time, effort, frustration, and money. Allow yourself space to think. If you're under pressure, prioritize your workload at the beginning of each morning. Deal with the things that are critical to your business, but don't let a sense of panic push you into making an impulsive decision. What will happen if you wait 1 or 2 days before setting the employment train in motion? Will the world come to a grinding halt? Will the whole business fail? It's unlikely. So remember to act, don't react. Immediate action. Determine what level of employee you're seeking. If advanced skill sets are not needed, then it's likely you may safely employ with minimal time loss. But the higher the level of employee, the more specific the skill sets, the more time it may take to fill the vacancy successfully. The initial thought process at this stage should be to categorize your prospective employee. What kind of person are you seeking to employ? Non-skilled. Manual labor, junior office, shop assistant, nursing auxiliary, and so on. Semi-skilled. Particular skills or experience which may be relevant to the post but don't necessarily involve high levels of education. Experienced. Particular skills relevant to the post backed by a professional qualification or levels of experience. Professional. Skills that have been honed by education or experience into increasingly specific targeted areas, usually backed by degree-level education or professional certification. Managerial or director. As professional, but backed by a suitable portfolio of successes. You may very well be able to fill the unskilled vacancy, or even the semi-skilled vacancy, within a month, taking into consideration applicants who are constrained by the location of their home, children's school, and spouse's workplace. But even at this level, to employ more particularly, you may have to take a week or a month's notice period into consideration. So, we're already up to a 2-month time span. As a ballpark figure, you can add an extra month for each step up the scale for skilled, professional, and managerial positions, taking into consideration that the higher profile the job, the more notice the candidate may be required to give, and the more particular you will be about the individual candidate. By the time you're at manager level, including project managers, you're likely to be looking at a timescale of not less than 6 months, and possibly a good deal more for a good, solid employment proposal. After this initial and fairly superficial evaluation of type of employee, you have to ask yourself a simple question. Can you or your business afford to wait that long? If you can, go on and plan your recruitment campaign using the guidelines set out in the following chapters. If not, you have 2 alternatives. 1. Recruit with immediate effect. 2. Employ a contractor or temporary employee, a temp, to tide you over. Recruiting hastily. If you need to recruit hastily, you'll probably advertise via your local employment agency, your local newspaper, local advertising boards. You can expect to find yourself recruiting either from those people who live locally and can give minimal notice, or those already out of work. If people are looking for a local job because of social constraints, you need to ask yourself, can they do the job? Just because they say they can doesn't necessarily mean that it's true. If this person needs any job, under any circumstances, are they likely to have any interest in the business other than receiving a pay packet? Are they really suited to the job, or are you panic buying from an available pool? If overqualified for the post, are they likely to move on if a better job came along? Could they add any long-term benefit to your firm other than the present specific requirements? If the person is presently out of work, why are they out of work? Don't let any of these questions prejudice your evaluation. A person may not be lacking in skills or levels of commitment just because they're local, and they may have a very valid reason for being out of work. There are also some very positive aspects in employing from the local pool. For example, the applicant may be readily available. Community spirit is still strong in some catchment areas, and some people prefer to work for a local firm. There will be no relocation fees to find. A person who is content with his location for a variety of reasons and shows no particular drive to find work out of the area may be more reliable as a long-term employee than one who is prepared to relocate. You may find a person who doesn't quite meet your criteria, but who is keen and very well worth training up to higher standards. Even if you're pressurized into employing at fairly short notice, you must still make an effort to understand the overall ethos and the kind of employee movement within the catchment area from which you're drawing. The temporary solution. As an interim solution, there are plenty of contractors or temps out on the market today, at all ends of the work spectrum. On the minus side, a contractor will usually be more expensive than an employee. To a certain extent, you have to take them at the face value of their CV or agent, though an interview is recommended. On the plus side, you can contract to employ such a person for an agreed length of time with no other employment commitments, as long as you don't keep that contractor over a specified length of time doing exactly the same job, after which they're deemed to be employed and will gain the benefits of an employed person. Contact the Inland Revenue for the relevant legislation. There's the possibility of renewing the contract if you fail to employ within the time limit, providing the contractor has no commitment to work after that period has expired. People often see contract work as a way of gaining experience and proving themselves, and many contractors have successfully moved into full-time employment. Note, unless you are clear about the legislation, it's wise to purchase your contractor requirement through a bona fide agency to avoid tax and Inland Revenue pitfalls.
In summary, we hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.